Welcome. Welcome to QI, where this week our food for thought is food. Surfing on a smorgasbord of succulents, ce soir is our delicious panel, the rarest of truffles, David Mitchell. The choicest of cats, Mitchell. The strangest of fruit, Jimmy Carr. And something furry that's fallen down the gap between the oven and the dishwasher, Alan Davies. Well, now we're all sitting comfortably, so let's ring for service. David goes. Jimmy goes. Rich goes. Alan goes. Right, now, before we tuck in, I've had a tongue down your... But you will find a tongue. I've put a tongue. Is there a tongue under there? You see?
Is this what you're referring
yes.
to?
Yes. There's a tongue. That is actually what's known as a tongue map. And during the course of this evening's festivities, I would like you to fill in the areas of the tongue that are responsible for which flavours. You may know there's a certain number of flavours that the tongue can detect.
So you're saying that each area is a different area of taste? So if you had that bit of your tongue, you know, lopped off, you wouldn't be able to taste certain stuff?
That's the theory of a tongue map. But there are only five things that a tongue can detect.
How does the food know where to go?
Anyway, while you're thinking about that, let's have a question. What kind of animal can you eat without killing it? Rich.
Crabs, unintentionally. In the South.
Yeah.
In the deep South, in the bayou. On the bayou. Freshwater mussels, they just pick them right out of the water, and they'll have these tiny pink crabs crawling on them, and they're considered a delicacy. And they're alive. They're alive when you swallow them.
These are things you can eat fully, an animal food stuff, but you don't kill the animal.
So something that sort of comes through like sweet corn, except it's still running around.
Oh!
Is that what you're saying?
No. No, I'm not saying it passes
it
through the
totally
entire
unharmed.
Digestive system.
Right,
no.
Oh, right.
No, no.
But this... it stays in you and this is sets up a community.
Whatever they put in Yakult. Well, they whittle on about that, don't they?
Yes, bifidus digestivum.
How?
Or L. Cassia
How
unitas.
Stupid do they think we are?
David, you know these things. I'm
well,
so
Well, as
impressed.
I spend a lot of time watching television, and listening to the new made-up science is very entertaining.
I love the made-up science where they go, do you want to buy a tiny pot of off milk?
Yeah. Yes! And they say it's always such a good deal. Just try it for 9 weeks. And then if you don't feel better, then give up. Because actually, if everyone tries it for 9 weeks, we're in the money.
And do ladies sit around discussing bloating a lot? Is that a thing that
they
happens,
have
in,
they
happens
tried
in
ladies,
the advert?
If there are ladies because watching this, and they've been talking about bloating,
have
they tried farting like a dock?
Oh.
Because it works remarkably well for me.
Trying
to get someone to pull their
lady
finger.
Bloating. Lady bloating is different, I believe.
Oh, they bloat differently.
I believe okay. so.
They also talk increasingly on the television about being constipated as well.
I've noticed
in
this
general,
that...
the standard of female conversation seems to be plummeting.
That's true. What happened to the little ladies who used to be so refined? Actually, in a sense, you're probably right about bacteria, which would possibly pass through us and all the way and not be killed, but this is actually a delicacy. I'm inclined to give the point to Rich because he's sort of accidentally right, only he's sort
as
of
usual.
Wrong as well.
It's not a story of my life.
It's one of the most popular foods, almost the national dish in some ways, of Florida.
Tapeworm.
Not tapeworm. No, it's a type of crab. It's a stone crab.
Oh, right.
Stone crab claws are very popular. There is a stone crab. And the fishermen catch the crab, they snap off the claws and throw the crab back in. And it takes about a year for its claws to grow back. But it is considered a great delicacy, usually served with a sort of butter and mustard sauce. Very popular, indeed, in restaurants up and down America, but particularly, as I say, in Florida.
What does it do for a year, then, armless down, wandering about?
I mean, he's up to himself.
So the crab is dismayed when it loses its claws, thinking, now I can't get any work done. All that stuff, I'm trying to rearrange the seabed. It'll be a year before I can do any of that. I'm just going to have to lay up. It's almost like they're sort of fruit-bearing animals, aren't they?
That's pretty similar to that, exactly. Yeah. Like an apple tree has its apples taken off, but the next year it grows more apples.
So maybe they're trees. They're just seafoody trees.
Yeah. They can walk around. Same DNA.
You could have given me as an answer as well, there are certain tribesmen in the Masai Mara in northern Tanzania and Kenya who will drink the blood of cattle, you know, not kill them, but sort of slit the throat a bit and drink the blood, and mix it with milk, actually. And then they bind up the wound again, and so they don't kill the cow. But that practice is dying out a bit.
They mix it with milk, so they think that cattle have two drinks.
You can have one or the other, or a mixture of the two.
Fantastic, these two-drink animals.
Anyway, stone crabs it is. They're returned to the sea alive and their claws have been taken off. Over the next year, they grow a replacement, although it's never quite as good as the first one. Now, what can you usefully teach an oyster? Yes.
Is it, you know, not to get its hopes up? to, you know, expect lemon juice and death? Struggle, it'll never work.
You teach it when you get lemons, make lemonade.
Oh,
cheer it on.
When you get lemons, you're seconds away from death. Because you're not like that kind of crab.
Well, when you think about it, there's not much an oyster can do, really.
You could teach it to blend into parties and make it look like it was invited.
It's true.
Could you teach it to...
Because if you went to a party and there's a snack tray, no one ever says, who invited the oysters?
That's true. No one says that.
Can you teach them how to do impressions? They do a brilliant impression of a whelk.
You could probably teach it rudimentary percussion. If you showed it a castanet, it would probably think, I can do that.
Well, you're very close now. What it is that out of the water, oysters will stay fresh so long as they're closed. But of course, they live their lives opening and closing their shells in order to let nutrients in, which they filter. So the thing is to teach them to keep their mouths closed for long periods of time.
You do that, like...
Well, the French did. The French simply hit them with metal rods, which makes them close, and they would do that for longer and longer times, and they would learn, they would respond, because they know they got hit all the time.
The French really have a gift for cruelty.
They do, don't they? Very special. But what happened in New York, when they first arrived in what is now New York, the settlers, they had never seen such a profusion of oysters. Some of them were a foot long. But they couldn't transport them around any other parts of the States because they would go off because they had their things open and there was no ice around. So what they did was they would move them up the bank at each tide so that they had more and more time in the air, and that would teach them to have their mouths closed for longer. So they would learn to have their mouths closed for longer and longer and longer, until they had them closed all the time, long enough for you to transport them and sell them and eat them without making people ill. Well, there we are. That's your oyster. Now, how did the Mounties use fruit machines to get their man?
When you say fruit machines, is this a friend of yours?
Oh, sorry.
He's a fruit machine.
A fruit machine.
Well, you're right in the sense the fruit machine was a nickname. It wasn't actually a one-armed bandit. It wasn't a gambling machine.
It's going to be something to do with actual fruit.
Is it?
No, it is actually the meaning of it that Jimmy, in his rapacious and, if I may say so, politically wildly incorrect way, went for.
Sorry, the Mountie uniform's quite fruity.
No, it's easy to forget with the Mounties. That's the Canadian police. If you're a policeman in Canada, you're a member of the Royal Canadian Mounties.
Oh, that's all of them there.
So they have no unmounted police?
Well, I don't know.
That must be difficult on raids in small flats. Ow, my head!
Well, you should see the squad cars. They're a mess, David. They are a mess.
Well, imagine trying to chase a heroin addict up a small staircase on a horse. That's ridiculous.
The heroin addicts would know to head for the small staircase.
Yes, they would.
It's like trying to police a country with Daleks.
Which would never work with the disabled access we got now. The Daleks can get everywhere.
Yeah.
Oh, this
is
true.
Jimmy, are you saying that you think that disabled access is a Dalek conspiracy?
Yes.
That is exactly what I'm saying.
No, we come back to this fruit machine. In the Cold War period, they were worried in a lot of Western countries about civil servants. There'd been a few scandals about civil servants being blackmailed. For what reason?
Homosexuality?
For being homosexual, for being gay. Now, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, they were trying to find out the homosexuals in the Canadian Civil Service.
Right.
So that they could not be honey-trapped by Soviet spies and so on. That was the theory of it.
So is one of these gay, then? Never mind the bus cops. Number three.
Was this before the RAF invented gaydar?
Yes, exactly. It was a gaydar machine, if you like. It was essentially a pretty primitive device which, amongst other things, showed people pictures of nude men and women and measured their pupil dilation and their perspiration. But the awful thing is, if they failed, as it were, they were sacked. That was their job over with. They were deemed to be homosexual and they were out of a job.
Of course, the whole system is thrown out for any civil servants who fancy horses.
Yeah.
All the people running the test in the room, you know, riding around the room, saying, can't quite reach down to the fruit machine, down these horses.
This crude measurement device was replaced, though, by something called...
Dancing on ice.
Do you like dancing on ice? Is this a trick question? Yes, I do. You're out.
Okay. No, you've got to answer, it's to die for.
It's a plethysmograph. And a plethysmograph is an instrument. There's two versions, a male version and a female version, because you're trying to catch lesbians here as well, apparently.
Ooh.
So the male version basically measures the tumescence of the male member when certain images are played to it. And for women, it's a sort of dildo that measures lubrication.
I wouldn't mind doing that.
What? Jimmy, so much is coming out here.
I'm just saying, testing.
You'd like to do that, would you?
Well, yeah, who got the testing job? That sounds brilliant.
Ooh, doesn't it? Oh, lovely.
Well, I'm just saying.
Yeah.
Be a giggle. When was this? When did they invent that?
Well, surprisingly recently. I mean, it was used up until the 80s.
To the 80s?
Yeah.
But surely it was legal and above board in the 1980s.
Well, exactly. It seems so
homosexual. Seems weird that they would just go, well, we'll just double-check that.
The odd thing about the fruit machine was the guy who brought it to Canada, was called Kurt Freund, had actually invented it. He was a German living in Czechoslovakia. He'd invented it in order to do the precise opposite. It was to catch out people who claimed they were gay and used it as exemption from serving in the Czechoslovakian army. Now, you have a choice of venues for dinner tonight. Russia or France. Describe the difference between Russian and French service.
Yes. In France, they give you lots of vaguely obstetric instruments to dismantle.
Right.
Things like frog legs and snails.
Oh, is it special cutlery?
All the stuff you would have your backyard fumigated for.
And in Russia,
they just go, there's a turnip. If you don't like it, you're going to Siberia.
You know what the Russian national dish is? Yeah. Empty.
Oh, no.
Not my fault.
Oh. I think I know the answer to this. I think it's that isn't almost all service now is what you call Russian service, which is sort of you have food in courses, one after another. And French service, which obviously the French don't, they have food in courses like everyone, like the Russians. But French service was everything sort of coming at once, like a kind of buffet.
That is an absolutely perfect answer. David Mitchell, have a handful of points. Completely correct.
Yeah.
And, of course, there's the tapas and mezzedit principle in lots of Middle Eastern and Mediterranean cooking. But you're absolutely right. The French, right up until the 19th century, all the courses would come in one big go, and you just helped yourself to everything. And then the Russian Prince Kurakin, who was the ambassador to Napoleon's court, he came and said, we have had this brilliant idea in Russia. It's used one course and then another. And this was considered absolutely staggering and revolutionary. And it caught on.
Then the Americans improved on it by making it able for you to drive through in a car.
Yes.
And get it in a bag. From a 16-year-old.
They did indeed.
With shingles.
David, I have to call you my teacher's pet, and you get a special fanfare instead of a forfeit for that, because that is absolutely brilliant. There you are. So you are teacher's pet.
I don't feel that cool.
It's not a cool thing to be, I'm afraid, but no. You do get points. Yeah. And for some people, that's important. Escoffier was the man who introduced this into private homes and, more importantly, into restaurants. What do you know about Escoffier? Anything?
David will know.
Yeah.
he, uh, started frog's legs.
You're absolutely right.
And I only know that because I went on David's radio show and found it out.
Oh, sure. Also, I should at this point say, in the QI annual, I did a page on Escoffier. So, I'm quite well...
Let's
hear it. This could be a good bit.
First name?
Auguste.
Brilliant.
And he...
Died in...
Oh, I can't remember.
A terrible house fire.
19...
He died in 1935. He lived a long time, 62 years.
And he sort of founded the Ritz Hotel in Paris and the Carlton Hotel in London.
And the Savoy.
And was the chef at the Savoy.
Brilliant. And what's his most famous dish?
Well, he invented peach Melba, didn't he?
Yes.
Dame Nellie Melba.
The Dame Nellie Melba.
He also apparently invented Melba toast for her as well, because she was dieting in between peach Melbas.
And who was Nellie Melba?
She was an opera singer.
And what was her real name?
Mitchell.
Yes, very good. I think
her father was called David Mitchell.
Get out. Do you know?
This is like Catnip.
I am truly impressed. If anyone thinks this is set up, it truly is.
You are tumescent. I know you are. Where's the fruit machine now?
Well, talking
about... You facts? Oh.
Anyway, I mean, I don't know, can I make you a double teacher's pet? Yes, I can! I'm going to give you another fanfare, because that was so extraordinary, your day. Yeah, look at that. Bravo.
I don't want to rain on your parade, but if you look closely, Stephen's pupils have gone 10 times bigger.
I am, as Alan rightly said, aroused by people who are passionate about interesting facts. Now... The fact is, until Escoffier introduced service à la Russe to Western Europe, meals were normally served all at once and eaten in whatever order you fancied. Now, let's have a look at your tasting maps of times coming. What have we got here? We'll start with you, Jimmy. What have you got?
I imagine you would taste failure there and success at the back. Ah. A bitter taste of resentment.
Ah, so bitter at the back, you think, possibly.
What are the tastes? It's salt,
sweet. Sour.
Sour. And then didn't they invent one, which is MSG? One.
Yes.
But they didn't discover it until 1911 or something bizarre?
Well, it's umami. It's the brothy, mushroomy, slightly...
I love it.
Savoury, exactly.
Sweet, salt.
Sour.
Sour. MSG. Bitter.
And, yeah, that's it.
Is that
five.
It?
Five.
What's Gordon Ramsay wittering on about in all those shows? If that's it.
That's on the tongue. There's a rainbow of things in the olfactory bulb in the nose. That's where all real flavours and things can be detected. But the tongue is only for those five. What have you got, Rich?
That's guilt, good. Remorse.
That's when you taste guilt.
Crabby.
David, what have you got for us?
I've got be sick, because it does make you be sick. And that's forgotten names on the...
Very good. Very good. Excellent. Alan?
I got bitter, sour and sweet, and then I ran out of ideas. I had savoury. I didn't think it was right.
That is umami. It's pretty savoury, yeah.
And then I had one left, so I just put jam in.
Well, for all we know, your tongue may.
Are any of these right?
No, the fact is, actually, all this, the whole tongue map idea is actually nonsense. Thank you. Throw your tongue over your shoulder, because...
Well, if I could do that...
Yeah, exactly. You'd
be happy.
Instead of me being a happy man, I wouldn't leave the house. She wouldn't let me.
Because you could lick your shoulder blade.
Well, the inference being...
Well, I suppose, yeah. We detect those five primary flavours all over the tongue and not in that. That used to be held to be the tongue map. And it's amazingly, it's still in quite a lot of textbooks. But it is absolutely not true. And so we come to the highlight of our feast, la pièce de générale ignorance. Elbows off the tables and fingers on the buzzers. Name a poisonous snake. Yes, Jimmy.
Piers Morgan. Whoa!
Poison is not the same as venom. It can't be. Because there are loads of poisonous snakes.
You sounded so like Jonathan Creek just then.
You suddenly hit.
Just somehow with a pen. Yeah. It's just so right. You
I've
went,
got it. I've got the
it.
Answer.
It can't
in a locked
be.
Room.
There are lots of them.
It's yeah, well, we haven't named one yet.
I'm not going to. They're all going to be up there. I refuse.
You're so right.
Yes. It could have
because
been. You were hoping.
We were hoping you'd say cobra and
he said it.
Rattlesnake. and all those sort of things. But of course, the word poisonous does not apply to them. It means if you eat it, it makes you very ill or kills you.
But venom goes...
Venom is something injected into your blood. So those are all venomous snakes. But there are only two poisonous snakes we could find. Ones that if you ate, they would kill you. You know, like a poison fruit or a poison berry. And they are, in fact, there's the Japanese grass snake. Rhabdophis tigrinus becomes poisonous by eating toxic toads, in fact. And it stores them in little glands in its neck. If you eat that, you'll die. Or there's the Thamnophthys sertalis, which is the common garter snake.
Stephen, what are you talking about?
It eats a poisonous newt, an orange-bedded, rough-skinned newt. Now, what shouldn't you eat before bedtime?
It's a trap.
Yeah, I can.
Us.
Cheese!
Oh! Bad dreams gives you bad
supposedly
dreams.
Supposedly gives you, but apparently, according to a study, it's been debunked in 2005. Apparently, it gives you actually good dreams. On the other hand, the study was instituted by the British Cheese Board.
Right.
It's called the British Cheese Board.
I think they're aware of the joke. But no, but they make the point that there's an amino acid in cheese, as there is in milk and all dairy products, called tryptophan, which is a thing that gives you peace and joy and tranquility and helps you sleep.
Now that's tamazepam.
That's also tamazepam. The tryptophan is a natural one. So the British Cheese Board says, let them eat cheese. But who said, let them eat cake?
Oh. Yes, it's that French woman.
Yes?
Dawn French.
Oh, very good.
She said, let them eat brioche.
Who did?
I'm not saying
But I'm asking you. I need to know.
Oh, was it Mr. Kipling?
Come on.
Oh, Jimmy.
Marie Osmond.
Marie Osmond.
Kirsten Dunst.
No.
Kirsten Dunst in that shocking film. It's the worst film ever made since Revolution with Al Pacino.
Did it involve cakes? Oh, a Marie Antoinette film.
Yes.
Oh, was it?
Did you say what? Who said it?
What you? Said.
Marie Antoinette.
Wait, why are you keeping on saying Marie Antoinette?
Because I want that to happen.
No, Marie Antoinette. Didn't say it, or if she did say it, she was quoting it. She was born in 1755, as every schoolboy knows, and the phrase was seen in print in 1760, and Jean-Jacques Rousseau claims to have seen it in 1740. So it's an old thing. It's this idea that it was Marie Antoinette is not true.
I think it's unfair. You want to hear the whole conversation.
Yeah.
They haven't got any bread. Let them eat cake. They haven't got any cake either. Oh, I understand this is a problem.
Yes.
I'll in some way talk to the ministers about it. We'll see what we can do.
Very. That might well have been the accusation that one grand lady or another committed this particular gaffe was in circulation at least 15 years before Marie Antoinette was born. Now, what makes up more than 70% of the internet?
Ooh.
It's my personal collection, isn't it?
Of what?
Of gentlemen's special interest literature.
I think we know what you're talking about.
Well, if you're going to be like that.
No, it's just quite surprising. They did a survey on behalf of the American Civil Liberties Union, who were very annoyed about some legislation that Bush was trying to push through, which they thought somewhat prohibitive of personal liberty, and they discovered that less than 1% of the internet is pornography. Less than 1%. Of all email traffic, 89% is spam. It's as simple as that.
Trying to sell you Xanax and penis enlargement.
Exactly. Soft Cialis, whatever that is.
The annoying thing about those, I get loads of them, most of them from my girlfriend, but it's the ones from my mum that really hurt.
Oh. Yay! Oh. Here's a recent study has established that the World Wide Web is less than 1% pornography, and on the other hand, 89% of all emails are spam, which is good news if you're looking for cheap pills or you want to increase your extremities. The exciting thing is that that brings us to the coffee and liqueurs, as it were, to the end of our little dinner and... L'addition, s'il vous plaît, garçon. And let's have a look at the scores. Well, it's pretty unsurprising to those who've been paying close attention that our runaway winner with a full 10 points is David Mitchell. Hurrah! It's well done to David with 10, and it's medium with -2 to Rich Hall. Way-hey.
-2.
it's a very rare third place for Alan Davis with minus 12. Yes, looking decidedly blue, it's Jimmy Carr with minus 46. It only remains for me to thank my fellow diners, Rich, Jimmy, David and Alan, and to leave you with the reproving words of our favourite dame, Dame Nellie Melba, on being presented with a gelatin-based pudding which had not been allowed to set properly. There are two things I like stiff, she said, and one of them's jelly. Good night.
'Lucy is getting married to save a car mechanic from being deported. Now that's romance. Not Going Out follows in just a mo. And later it's Lionel Richie, Van Diesel and music from The Sparks. Friday night with Jonathan Ross at 10:35.